And Ash.
Hey, Screamers, this is Tough Guy.
And I'm James.
I'm Caleb.
And this is Scream.
And today we're covering an absolute gem of a movie that our associates decided to skip out on. They just really, you know, they don't appreciate a good microwave is what I got from this.
To be fair, this isn't for everybody.
To be fair, microwaves are in every household.
From 1967 till today, they weren't always. So when this movie came out, it was kind of a new invention.
Can we have this whole microwave in Halloween?
Yeah.
We had this whole Halloween microwave discussion.
Oh, yeah.
Whether or not Michael would know how to use a microwave.
Would know how to, or what a microwave even is.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which I guess knowing how to use it was part of it because he used it in an interesting way.
Right.
Yeah, microwaves are the point of discussion today. Microwaves are very important. What do you guys think about microwaves? How often do you use a microwave?
I actually use a microwave every single day.
Period.
I would rather not use them, but...
I would rather not.
Yeah, yeah.
I do use one every day.
I don't think I use one every day. I use them fairly often, but honestly, I mean, I use stoves, like stovetop cooking stuff, and then like toss some stuff in like an air fryer or something like that pretty often, or an oven.
Yeah.
I don't catch myself using microwaves very often. To melt a cheese?
Melt a cheese.
Definitely a microwave type thing. If I'm making ramen, it's funny. I say stovetop and stuff, but I will not make ramen.
That's funny.
On the stove. I won't. I just toss in the microwave because when I...
about waiting for that pot to boil is so much longer than 3 minutes.
It's not worth the money. I'm paying 19 cents for a pack of ramen, and I'm going to stand in front of a pot, a boiling pot, and move the noodles around for what, like 20, 30 minutes? That's insane. Ramen is meant to be microwaved because it is a on-the-go food. It might not be on-the-go. Not really at all. But you know what I mean. It's like one of those things that I want to just be like, oh, I want ramen. So I'm going to get it. I'm going to put it in a bowl. I'm going to put water in it, put a little bit of seasoning in it. I'm going to put it in the microwave. And when I come back, it's done, and I'm eating it.
Yeah,
and
no, I get that.
So that's
my thing with my microwave is I never drink my coffee fast enough. So I always end up microwaving it just a little bit.
That was going to be my question. Like, what was the daily microwave occurrence?
Always use it for coffee.
When do you hop into a microwave, Tough Guy?
Not
physically.
Yeah, well, I mean, after watching this movie.
Like, well, this microwave was rather large. I mean, big-ass microwave.
You got to throw your cappuccinos, your coffees in there. Remember the cappuccino cake we had? That was fun.
I know. I kind of want to bring it back.
Yeah, I got tired of them. You guys like brought them over the first few times. I was like, this is great. And immediately I was sick of them, and you guys were still drinking them 8 months later. Like four a day for like months.
Got to chase the dopamine, man.
So, Tough Guy, you have a microwave occurrence?
No, not at all. I really try to avoid them. I really don't like them.
Another thing, microwave burritos.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I know I could put them in the oven, too. That's another thing that I just won't do. Yeah. I'm like, I grew up on, like, getting a little, like, two paper towels, folding them, getting them wet, scrunching them up, getting some of the water out, getting them a little damp, putting them over the burrito.
Oh, wow.
Put it in the microwave, and that's how I'm going to eat microwave burritos for the rest of my life.
Damn.
So, that's probably the other thing. Most other things I'll toss in an oven. And this is all relevant, guys. I know you might be thinking, oh, you're talking about a microwave a lot for a horror movie podcast. This is so relevant, it's crazy. there are a lot of microwave discussions that need to be had today.
Microwaves?
Microwave. Massacre.
It's about right.
So Microwave Massacre, it was released in 1983. it was made in 1979, and it's very interesting because it was originally shown in 1979 in Austin, Texas, but it wasn't released until 1983. I'm pretty sure they had some issues with the distribution, and they just couldn't get anyone who really wanted to mess with Microwave Massacre, you know? They just... Yeah. They couldn't find the love it needed. It truly deserved, you
Sometimes
know?
Sometimes art isn't understood by the masses.
And this is art, like, to the nth degree, if I'm being completely honest. This might have been the best thing I've ever experienced in my life. it's pretty funny, though. In the last episode, I feel like I need to, like, circumvent what I said before, because in the last episode I was like, this is such a piece of shit. I was like, it's so bad, like, there's nothing good about it, it's just an awful movie. I don't feel that way about this. I genuinely don't. This was, I mean, I thought I did, but after rewatching it, like, what am I talking about?
This was a-okay, man.
This is pretty good. This was swell. It was written by Thomas Singer, who's only ever written on Microwave Massacre and a movie called Malibu High, which kind of comes back around in a lot of the cast and crew in this.
Okay.
And also Craig Muckler, who wrote on Microwave Massacre in 79, Mark and Clark World Adventures in 2020, and finally Demonoids this year in 2023.
Oh.
Yeah, it came back still around, rolling, which is crazy. This was directed by Wayne Berwick, son of piano prodigy Irvin Berwick, who has only, and I actually think his name might not be pronounced Irvin. I think it's like spelled Irvin, but I don't think it is. I think I just butchered that, if I'm being honest, but it's spelled I-R-V-A-N. He's only directed three films, Microwave Massacre, Attack of the B-Movie Monsters, and The Naked Monster.
Sounds great.
So the thing about Malibu High is that it was the last film directed by Mr. Berwick, not Wayne, but his father. Mm-hmm. And regarding Demonoids... So, I just discussed Amityville Toy Box, the 19th chronological Amityville on Horror Soup recently. By the way, guys, it's a Horror Soup Takeover!
Hey!
These are my Horror Soup guys, for anyone that isn't... probably should have said that earlier. For anyone who isn't privy, we got Tough Guy right here, James. We already said that, but these are my dudes over on Horror Soup. We do pretty much episodes just like this weekly on Horror Soup.
Movies, yeah, like this, definitely. Actually, too.
Soup, yeah, basically, yeah.
Yeah, this is like a Horror Soup pick. It makes sense that I'm here.
Yeah, and I tried to get Ash and Elena to do it, and, well, really, I've been, like, talking to you the whole time, but they had some important family stuff going on. There have been, you know, life be hitting sometimes. But, yeah, I mean, really, after watching this, I was like, wow, it's crazy that, like, we're not doing this on Horror Soup.
Right.
But then it ended up turning out that we got to take over. So like, I think it works out, because this is a movie that I needed Mr. Tough and Mr. James here for. So anyway, regarding Amityville and Horror Soup and all that stuff, Demonoids is directed by Dustin Ferguson, the director of over three different Amityville movies, including Toy Box.
Oh, boy.
Oh.
Yeah. So the movie is starring Jackie Vernon.
Jackie Vernon.
He was a frosty, snowy man.
Yeah, that's how it goes.
Those are terrible musicians. As the two musicians in the room, I gotta go ahead and say...
No, we nailed it.
You guys gotta quit. After that, you're done. Yeah, so Jackie the... Fuck.
Been a good run?
So Jackie...
I think you're done podcasting, too.
Guys, we're all fired immediately. This is over. Jackie Vernon, the man was fucking Frosty the Snowman. I mean, that's
well
crazy.
The voice,
and he's Microwave Massacre,
and he's, I mean, define Microwave Massacre.
Yeah,
because I mean, this movie's great, but like,
there was a microwave and there was a massacre. Doesn't it take like three people to, you know, claim three lives for it to be a massacre? It's a super low number,
spot, though. Or does it have, like, at that point, it's microwave serial killer, it's right?
Yeah, he's more of a serial killer.
This is definitely microwave serial killer.
Yeah.
But, I mean, if they called it microwave serial killer,
it doesn't sound nearly as good.
Like, that sounds terrible.
Yeah.
No.
You like microwave serial killer?
No, I don't.
No, I thought he was about to defend. He was be like, you know what? So the thing about microwave serial killer,
there's just not enough microwave. There's not enough of the microwave in general.
I would argue that there's not a lot of the microwave.
It's just
there's a decent amount. There's like a box. There's the microwave. There's like, hey, yada yada yada, microwave. There's a lot of microwave talk.
Yeah, but not, I don't know. The title is really misleading when you're watching it, and then how you, well, when you see it unfold, it's.
But what can you do with a microwave other than just cook things?
I'm gonna be honest. When I first heard this title, I thought the microwave was gonna come to life and
destroy people. I thought it was gonna be like a killer sofa type thing, you know?
Yeah, like I thought the microwave would attack. To be fair, like, if you're expecting like an inanimate object attacking things, that's not gonna happen. The microwave isn't.
Yeah, that's not the movie.
Well, it kind of did at the end. It attacked.
I was going to say, it kind of does. So it is a microwave massacre. I take it all back.
Straight for the heart, man.
Well, that's one person in one place.
It's not a massacre.
Well, I guess a lot of them happen at the same place, just at a different... That's just a serial killer.
Yeah.
That's not... Okay, well, I have no point. I have no point to make here. Anyway, Microwave Massacre is not a movie filled with stars, but it does include an appearance from Robert A. Burns, who is the art director on the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the original Hills Have Eyes, Tourist Trap, The Howling, Reanimator, among many others.
Woo!
And he's a dude rummaging through the trash that finds that like arm or the leg. Okay. Oh, I think it was an arm. Yeah. Shout out Robert Burns. He's really the reason that Texas Chainsaw is like what it was. I think we talked or discussed him like a good amount on the Texas Chainsaw episode a while back. Mm. He's the dude that like got the like the dead possum that you see in the beginning of the movie. And like, you know, he would just like outsource things that were actually like grotesque things, but you know, they worked really good for camera.
Right.
I'm pretty sure he's the reason that there was like, you know, just meat sitting all over the table and like shit like that, you know, that people definitely got like terribly sick off of.
Yeah.
But the movie looks great.
It does.
And again, the star of the flick is comedian Jackie Vernon. And I mean, really at the time this came out, I mean, Jackie Vernon was pretty popping too.
Yeah.
I mean, his comedy was going pretty good. People knew him. There was one story that, that was told that apparently they were shooting the movie and they didn't have like, Craig Muckler said that they didn't have a permit to like, you know, shoot wherever they were.
Mm-hmm.
And then a cop came by and they were about to like, you know, like, tell them to fuck off or whatever. They were like, oh shit, we're kind of fucked right now. And then they were like, oh yeah, well, we're making this movie like with Jackie Vernon. He was like, Jackie Vernon, do you want me to stop traffic right now? So you can like stop finish shooting this?
Stop construction.
I mean, I'll do it for Jackie Vernon.
So crazy. I mean, pretty fire, but yeah, dude. I mean, they would never stop construction for this movie. Come on, tough guy. Like,
someone tried to stop construction. We'll get to that.
That's definitely true. I would actually argue that they didn't try. Fully succeed. I didn't see a lot of work going on, except for that one dude that's just like hauling a giant piece of metal. He's just throwing it around back and forth, like playing catch with himself with it. Can you imagine? Like, that's the buffest thing you can do.
It is.
There's nothing stronger than that.
Nope.
Anyway, there's also a man listed as Dick Nibbler.
Nice.
Which, like, he doesn't have any other credits, and I can't even confirm that that's a real person. I'm pretty sure, because, like, I'm pretty sure that's a fake name.
Yeah.
That's a fake name that they just put in for this so that someone would have the credit Dick Nibbler. And I wanted someone to address that in, like, the director's commentary, behind the features, online. Like, I tried to look it up. I was like, Dick Nibbler, Microwave Massacre. Right, I was trying to just, like, find anything. I don't know anything about this Nibbler guy.
That's a bummer.
But... you know, I think that's a really funny name.
Dick Nibbler.
And honestly, if that is his name, legend.
Mm.
Legend. Probably got so bullied. Like, terribly, like, beat up. Could you imagine being in middle school? And everyone's like, what's your name? They already called it out. You know, it's like the beginning of class. They're like, Dick Nibbler. Wait, do we have a Dick Nibbler?
No, that dude was cool. They're like, hey, Dicky Nippy, let's go.
Dicky Nippy? Where's the nippy come
nibby,
from?
Nibby, Dicky Nibby.
I'd be so pissed. I mean, your parents hate you if they named you Dick Nibbler.
This isn't like a Llamageddon type thing, right? Where everyone just has ridiculous names.
No, everyone else was credited.
That's
just
what,
like,
I was thinking. Maybe it's just one guy.
Yeah,
he didn't want to just use his real name, so they just gave him some goofy name.
He didn't want to be a Nibbler. Yeah. He didn't want to be attached to this film.
I just wish there was some acknowledgement, though. You know, just like, hey, that was like so and so's buddy or this and that, whatever. And like, you know, just said that like he didn't want to be in, so we named him Dick Nibbler. Because we thought Dick Nibbler
was gonna be
funny.
Me if I ever help you make a movie. I'm not using my real name.
Talk about your real name is all over this podcast. People would just be like,
"Yeah, but not the movie."
the movie. Anyone that watched the movie would just like start commenting on whatever anyone else is viewing it on. They'd just be like, yeah, that's James.
Nope.
They'd be like, he's always calling out like where he lives, places by his house on this podcast. He's just like calling out everything on a podcast. Nope,
that's not me. I didn't make that movie.
The most traceable person is like, I want to be uncredited on this movie.
Not attached to that.
I mean, dude, like, I'll do anything to be called Dick Nibbler, but I'm not going to act like people can't trace me. They're going to be like, yeah, that's Caleb. Dick Nibbler.
No.
Oh, God. Okay, so the budget of Microwave Massacre is between $70,000 and $80,000, most likely around $75,000. Honestly, impressive.
Yeah.
I think it looked pretty good. That stain
for that.
That stain on the couch was worth more than that alone. That was a $100,000 stain, if you ask me. That was art, dude. You can't get something like that. They taped a banana to a wall and sold that for like millions. Replaced the banana, which I feel like makes it less art, but apparently it's still the same art. Art's subjective. I'm sorry.
The way that couch scene sat, it was right in the middle, and it kind of looked like the guy came home from work every day with like just sweating and sitting in that same spot, and it just like seeped through.
Okay.
Yeah, all the way through. Oh, yeah. I'm talking real sweaty.
Well, did we see the other side of the couch ever?
No. Well, yeah, when they were laying on it, you know,
was
doing
that
the thing.
In the middle too?
I don't think so.
It would have to be on both sides. It would seep through that much.
Yeah, I'm not sure, but
it have to be.
In that first shot, I was like, ooh.
I just don't get. I think at one point too, in the director's commentary, they mentioned the stain on the couch. They're like, that's a very peculiar stain. And then they just move on, and I was so pissed. I was like, wait, come on.
Wait.
If they at least said, like, I don't know how the stain got there, you know, like, I try to figure out, I'd be, like, a little satisfied, but I was like, come on, dude. Like, that's, you can't just move on.
Left in the shot. Whose house did you say this was?
So I was going to get to that in a second. It's okay. Okay, we can do that now. James, did you know this? The house that is the set of Microwave Massacre, basically.
Right.
You know the band The Monkees?
Yeah.
What's the most popular song?
Hey, we're the monkeys. No, people say we monkeys.
I'm sorry, not that. The other, that's not, trust me. The other one.
I don't know. Last Train to Clarksville.
Dude, you ever watch Shrek?
Oh.
Yeah. Unbelievable.
I mean, wasn't that like...
Out of trace.
That's
out of my mind.
It's a cover.
Yeah, that's the cover, though.
Smash.
Shrek
Smash Mouth version.
Yeah, Shrek Smash popularized it.
The Smash Mouth version.
Shrek popularized the monkeys by through Smash Mouth. Shrek popularized the monkeys.
How? They're not attached to it whatsoever.
The monkeys would be rolling in their grave right now if they heard that you thought that Shrek wasn't the reason that they're popular.
That they had any attachment to whatsoever. Because
trust
someone
me.
Covered one of their songs, probably completely uncredited.
I'm a believer. That a trace.
Yeah. You got it.
So the monkeys, I'm just saying, they wouldn't be anywhere without Shrek.
You're probably right.
Thank you. But Mickey Dolenz?
Oh, yeah, Mickey. So that was my question. Is this his furniture?
I'm pretty sure. He was selling his house.
That's why I was asking.
He was selling his house, and...
it's probably his microwave.
Dude, I wouldn't be surprised. What was it called? The fucking defibrillator 93-tron? Microwaves were built different back then.
Master Electric.
The names are the same names as like Elon Musk's child. It's so crazy. Anyway. Yeah. Fucking Mickey Dolenz's house is the set of Microwave Massacre, and I'm pretty sure this was just how his house was built. Like, this was all his furniture, like, all those, like, weird gold statues he had around, everything. That was just his place.
I mean, that makes sense.
But when I was working for the radio or a radio show, we interviewed Mickey Dolenz. He's a cool dude, though. His house is cool, too, just, you know.
Yeah, see, and that's a big drop. Because I was talking to Tough Guy about how this was Mickey Dolenz's house. And then he was just like, I interviewed Mickey Dolenz once. I was like, wait. I was like, it's actually really good that you're going to be on this Microwave Massacre episode. Because I'm like, you somehow have the connection to the house in Microwave Massacre. Talk more about Mickey Dolenz, dude. What was the Mickey Dolenz?
I don't know. It was a few years ago, but it's just a music podcast. So we were just talking about the old school days, you know, the monkey days, nothing crazy.
So now, even be disrespectful, like, but is Mickey Dolan still alive?
Yeah, he's still alive. Okay. I think half of them are. Davy Jones is gone, and then Yeah, Davy Jones' locker. Yeah, he's gone, and then yeah, there's another one that just passed away. I think I think they're still two alive.
Wow.
Yeah,
and Mickey Dolan's is one of them. Yeah, still
absolutely. He's been present for a while.
You think his house is still around?
Maybe not that one, because, you know, that was from...
They sold it, like, literally right after this, but I wonder who bought that house, and it's just like... Do you think they ever saw Microwave Massacre, and they were like, huh, where'd that stain come from?
Yes, like, they stained my couch and broke my microwave. Where's all this tinfoil in my fridge?
And they're like, you're like, so that's why they left a microwave prop in my house that doesn't fucking work? That they drilled into the wall?
Giant ass microwave.
Can you imagine, like, they can't get that microwave prop out? They're just like huge. This giant piece of shit. That's actually so funny. Anyway, I don't believe this was released in the theater, but I also don't know. I almost feel like it was, because, like, 83, I'm like, why would you release a movie in 83 to not get a theater release, you know? I mean...
Yeah. At least drive-in, right?
Right, or something. Like, it had to have been that, but, like, I couldn't find a box office. I don't think I remember them talking about it being released in a theater or not.
Yeah, this would have been great in the drive-in.
Yeah, I don't know what happened to it or where it was released when it came out. I wish I had that information. Well, and maybe I just, like, missed it somewhere, but, like, I don't know. I watched... bunch of shit and, like, looked at a bunch of stuff and I couldn't find it. So,
well, now you can watch it on Tubi.
I hope someone knows, and someone's just, like, listening and, like, yeah, I saw Microwave Massacre in 1983 at so and so drive-in, because I don't know. I want to hear about that. Anyway, it wasn't rated, which almost makes me believe that it wasn't released somewhere. Yeah. I mean, but what did we just talk about the other day that wasn't rated that definitely had a theater release? Wasn't it Wolf Creek 2?
Yes.
Or no? Oh, yeah, because it had a box office or something, right? That's weird.
Yep.
How does that happen?
I have no idea.
Anyway, Rotten Tomatoes critics did not rate this. The audience gave it a 35%. It has an IMDb rating of 4.2 out of 10 and a Letterboxd rating of 2.2 out of 5. And, you can watch this on Tubi. You already said that, huh?
Yep.
Watch this on Tubi. And we're going to get into the episode in a second, but this is a Horror Soup Takeover. And with that, this episode will be posted on the Horror Soup YouTube. So go ahead and check it out. You look up Horror Soup on YouTube. And if you want to check out Horror Soup and me, James, and Tough Guy together and all that other stuff, just look up Horror Soup on all the streaming platforms. It's on YouTube. It's on all that stuff. We post, like, video episodes of everything on Spotify. And then we sporadically post YouTube videos. But this one... this one, I'll do it. Hopefully on time, guys.
Hey.
Yeah. Anyway, with that, you guys want to get into Microwave Massacre?
Start.
Let's massacre some microwaves.
Let's start strutting down the street, baby. She's working it, man.
So we actually opened before that on the comically large microwave. Like, the first thing you see is just, like, you're, what, inside of it zooming out, or are we outside of it zooming
outside
in?
Outside of it zooming in.
That's classic.
It's very, very reminiscent of the way Halloween 3 starts.
I feel like it looks like a space station, but when you make a space station out of a box and put tinfoil on it and then, like, you know, like, draw some lights on it with a Sharpie. It looks pretty great. Like, I couldn't even tell it was a microwave at first. I was like, what is this?
It just looks like some sort of computer or something. Like...
was it Death Spa?
Death Spa.
Had those computers that was just like a fucking pin board that they just like cut a hole in and then like stuck some fucking like fake screens
just
on.
Just a little CRT inside of it.
Yeah, it's like kind of that energy. But we start to zoom into this microwave until we like make it to a very mummified detached head, which is a foreshadow of, you know, what's going to happen.
Hang on a second. Can I also bring up, do we ever see this exact head again?
At the end,
head,
right?
We see at the end, isn't that a different head?
Probably.
I feel like this one looked better than the one that they used in the end.
I do think it was a different head.
Right?
If I'm being honest.
We do see a head at multiple times throughout the movie, but I don't believe it was this one. This prop didn't look that bad. The other one looks like shit.
I think this early on one was a different head from the rest of them. No, that other one looks fire, dude. You're talking about, what's her name, Marge?
Yeah.
Meg? Is it Meg?
I don't...
Maggie?
I don't remember. Is it Meg? Shit. I think it is Meg.
I wrote it down somewhere. We'll get to it eventually. We'll get to the name. But anyway, we're on this fucking microwave, the mummy head, all that stuff. This would have been a great spot for a title card.
Would have been.
But there just isn't one. Instead, it says Real Life Productions presents ... And it's like real as an R-E-E-L. I think there's probably a fish on it or something. I don't know. And then it goes Jackie Vernon ... And then like, it's still like fading in and out, like doing this every time. And then it goes in ... And then it fades out again. And then we see like a gal's tuchus. And then we finally see Microwave Massacre, like the title card. I was like, this is the craziest buildup for a title card I've ever seen.
Amazing.
I kind of love it. Like, it's so bad, but like, it's definitely the definition of so bad it's good.
Yeah.
Because it was crazy. I was like, the fact that you didn't just like show me a microwave and toss on the fucking Microwave Massacre, or like do anything and then show that is absurd. Yeah. But when I saw the in, and then it just like faded in and out within, I was like, this is crazy.
So 70s, and I love it.
That's so good. So this woman, she begins to walk, and the intro continues. Tough guy, you want to talk about
strutting? She's not walking, strutting. And we're just going down the street, but it's exaggerated and animated. She's working the shoulders, working the hips, you know. And where is she going? To a construction site. Why? I don't know if we ever figure it out.
No, we don't. I got to answer that question for you. We'd never figure that out, and we won't.
Everything she does, I'm confused, honestly, but it's...
I'm very confused by the next thing she does.
Yeah.
I mean, do you want to take it? You want me
no,
to take
that, it? No, you got it. I don't know how to explain it.
Okay, well, I know how to explain it, I guess. I mean, like, she comes across, like, a couple construction workers, or I guess we do. I'm sorry. We come across a couple construction workers. Mm-hmm. One of those construction workers, or of them, three are sitting on lunch break, and what happens next is peculiar, to say the least. The woman sees a hole in some lumber.
Like a fence.
Yeah, like a two ball shaped hole.
Yeah.
And she walks over it, she looks through, sees what's going on. Behind her is a man with large hair. She's kind of just bent over looking in the hole still. He walks over. It seems like he squeezes her butt, and then it seemed like maybe she like bonked him off screen.
Something got cut, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, the screen moves right here. Like, we don't see what happens, like, after the butt squeezing, but, like, seems like he got bonked, because then he's gone, and I heard some kind of noise.
Then she fell and got stuck?
No.
No, don't do it. No.
I would argue that that's not what happened, actually. Like, you would think, maybe.
Unsure about the details.
Well, if porn rules follow, then you're right. Then that is what happened. She fell and she got stuck, and somehow a stepbrother, like, falls into the equation.
Oh, yeah.
But I don't think that's what happened here. Okay, what we're alluding to, she takes her shirt off, and then she sticks her breastises in the two-ball-shaped hole in the lumber. And then...
she tripped because the guy grabbed her butt. And she tripped and she fell.
She fell with her shirt off.
Well,
I'm following. No, I get it. So I don't know.
Sometimes
after
they're hard to secure.
So after the possible bonk, you know, I mean, or the conveniently shaped breast-shaped hole is now filled. And one of the construction men, played by Al Trope, who appears in Mike Tristano's Feast, which apparently might be like an unofficial sequel to this movie. I could not find it anywhere, so I wasn't able to confirm. But on the director's commentary, they're like, yeah, this is kind of the sequel to it. Couldn't find it. Didn't watch it. So unfortunate. But Feast might be. I don't know if that's like an inside joke that they were telling. It might have been that. But anyway, he notices the breast in the hole and starts going that way. And when he's asked where he's going, he says,
I gotta go to the bathroom.
He says, I gotta go to the restroom.
Yeah.
He says, I gotta go to the restroom. And then he says, I mean the restroom. Meanwhile, Jackie Vernon is one of the other construction workers of the three, and he just pulls out a king crab sandwich so casually.
Not in a good way. Like it's just
fully cooked king crab shell on.
It's just a fucking horseshoe crab. Like, it wasn't appetizing whatsoever.
It is a full giant crab shell on. Doesn't even look like it's cooked. Like, I don't know. Yeah. It might still be alive. And there's just like two giant pieces of thick bread on top of each side. Like, the fucking claws are hanging out. The whole shell's hanging out.
This
is the biggest crab in the world.
How is anyone supposed to eat this?
No. And also, that was probably like a $200 crab.
Easily.
Like, that was the biggest crab. I got less crab than that the other day, and I spent like 60 fucking bucks on it. Like,
this one's made of rubber.
Like
every prop in this movie.
Buddy, I am in this fully. I'm submerged in this movie, trust me. So anyway, this very real, very expensive crab that he pulls out, everyone's just like, dude, that's the coolest lunch I've ever seen.
Look at that lunch, bud.
Because really...
No, it looks like he's going to run away.
No, my favorite part was like, right when Jackie pulls it out, fucking... his buddy that's sitting next to him, he looks at it, and his eyes get all big, and he jumps. Like, he just does a little, like, jump in his seat.
I'd be afraid.
But, like, there's just, like, wonky music playing the whole time. It's just like...
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And, like, the music's just playing while he's just sitting there. He pulls out the crab, his buddy just jumps, and it just, like, no dialogue whatsoever, and it just, like, moves on to the next scene. It was so funny. So, anyway, crab sandwich aside, the other construction worker notices the woman with her boobs in the wall, and he starts running full speed toward her, like, just running.
He's running like Shaggy Doo.
Can you imagine, like, I don't know, like, you see boobs in public, you just start running at them, like, what are you...
Just charge them.
What are you trying to accomplish?
I have no idea.
That's like that Always Sunny episode where, like, he's on that date, and then, like, Max, like, make a move, and Charlie just, like, fucking tries to grab her boobs. He's like, what? And he's like, Charlie's like, what do you mean? What was I supposed to do? And he's like, well, not fucking charge at her breasts like torpedoes. Like, what are you talking about? That's never the move.
Apparently, like, is for this guy.
His move is crazy. So he, like, runs over, and his other buddy too, like, you know, he was trying to be casual about it when he was going to the breast room, and he was like, right, walking right, over right. But then when he sees his buddy running, he tries to run over. Somehow the new dude who starts running beats him. Like, he's on a fucking mission. He runs right by, runs all the way over, and then he knocks a guy, like, this dude's eating his food, and he knocks him over and knocks him all of, like, 10 feet into the air when he runs by. It's fucking hilarious. And when he gets to the end, too, like, the girl, like, because she's sitting there with her, eventually, like, she takes her bra off, too, and, like, her bare breasts are, like, in there, like, in the hole, and then she starts, like, bouncing up and down, like, it's a whole weird thing. And at one point, too, I was like, is, like, the guy that squeezed her butt, like, fucking her now or something? Like, what is happening? That's not what's happening.
Yeah, no.
It's not what's happening.
First time watched, that did come across my mind. I thought that's what was going on. Because,
like, it's just so absurd. It's like, what is going on here? Man. Like, you're trying to explain it in your head, but there's no explaining it. Really.
Nope.
It's just some weird otherworldly stuff. But yeah, she's, like, sitting there, like, bouncing her boobs up and down and shit, and then, like, the dude tries to get over there to, like, he's going, like, you know, torpedo at her breasts, and he tries to grab them, and then she, like, just moves back and then walks away, and he, like, sticks his hands to, and he's, like, bouncing them all around, like, trying to grab everywhere, and then he, like, puts his face in it and starts, like, looking around. He's like, oh. It's like, all right, dude, like, you're, come on, buddy. Let's be so real about this.
Yikers.
So at this point, we're introduced to Donald's wife, May. So this woman just got an incredible piece of equipment. She got the microwave. It's like a AX174S or some shit like that. Like, hell, it's yeah, literally the same name as Elon Musk's child. It's the same intense name. I'll make the same joke again, because come on, this is an XJ13 ass microwave. I don't know what it is.
It's a microwave, man.
You laughing at tough guy?
It's a microwave. It looks like they pulled it off of, like, a Star Trek set or something.
Yeah,
man.
It looked like
big old buttons.
Yeah,
it looks like the spaceship control panel in, like, Jason X. Mm-hmm. But we'll get back to the microwave soon. Right now, we need to deal with Jackie Vernon complaining about the microwave. We'll get back to it right now. He sounds sluggish, sad, uninterested.
Can we also talk about the dog real quick,
dude? I barely remember that. Are you talking about the food?
Just the dog we see, she's talking, that's how we get introduced to the microwave, right. It's because she's talking to the dog, and she's like, it's gonna be so much better for you, and she looks at this dog, this is the...
What the dog doing, James?
What is the dog doing, this poor thing? It's like a tiny little, like, teacup Yorkie.
When he's, like, flipping around.
But, like, it can't keep its tongue in its mouth.
It might not have teeth.
It probably does have teeth. I was like, how's this poor thing alive?
You ever see those ugly dog competitions where they're just like...
I got a friend with a cool dog named Lila that has her tongue hanging out all the time.
Oh, yeah.
She's cool, though. Shout out Lila.
So, yeah, that's Jackie's dog.
He's a good dude. Good dog right there.
They share a lot of things. We'll get to that.
For sure. So, anyway... He's all sad and everything is because his wife is obsessed with this new microwave she has, and he just wants a classic sandwich, you know? That's all he wants out of life, just a sandwich.
Bologna sandwich.
But, you know, he's going to go to the bar because, you know, he needs to, like, wallow his sadness away.
Wallow away in beer and crab.
Mm-hmm. The barkeep, he has hemorrhoids.
He's like, I took this job standing up.
Seemingly real bad ones at that.
That's amazing. He's like, fuck it. Everybody's going to tell me their problems. I'm going to tell them my problems.
Pretty fair and reasonable. You got to start doing it after a while. Mm. This whole hemorrhoid thing leads to like a minute long staring contest between him and a confused Jackie. Cause Jackie's like, what about your hemorrhoids? Donald's, wait, what? I don't know what I wrote here. Oh. I had a thing about Donald's neighbors.
Oh yeah.
You guys want to talk about their neighbors for a bit?
That we don't ever figure out what's happening next door, do we?
It's an orgy.
They're yeah. Like, I just feel like it was none of Donald's business, you know? It's just they're doing their thing.
By the end, she kind of makes it his business.
I'm not gonna say by the end. I'm gonna say at all fucking times they make it his business. What are you talking about?
I feel like the first time was completely innocent. Like, he just saw something when he's walking by that maybe they didn't expect him to see.
No, they're winking at him. The whole fucking time. Every time he looks in there, they're like winking at him and like fucking gesturing toward him.
Well, yeah, I guess you're right.
Like, they want him to join this weird orgy they got going on over there. Like,
but why?
I don't know. Some fucking like milkman knocks on the door at one point. And they just like fucking yank him right in.
You're right.
So, I mean, really, I think anyone that looks at them, they're like, you want to fuck?
Yeah, I guess.
Want to come over here to house 1400? It's crazy, dude. They're just partying all the time. Like, I mean, there's naked women and men there at all times.
Gardening, too. Don't forget the gardening.
Gardening with dildos, for sure. I would agree with that statement.
Vibration makes the hole bigger, right? Easier, you just kind of, yeah.
I've heard before that vibration makes the hole bigger.
Yeah. Makes it easier to plant your seeds.
It's like an arousal thing. Oh, wait, what are we talking about?
Yeah, dude.
Which seed are you talking about?
Man.
Which seed? Okay, gardening. Hold on. Anyway. So Donald goes into his house after all of this, whatever the fuck is going on next door, and we see that his wife cleaned up the house real good, and she warns him not to sit on the couches with his grimy outside clothes, and in response, he stands directly on the couch with his shoes. Like, he looks in, he just stands on, he's like, starts like wiping his shoes off on the couch, and he starts reading his newspaper.
Yeah, and I'm realizing, like, yeah, of course there's stains all over this couch.
He's dancing on the back of it, like with glue on the back, on the bottom of his shoes somehow. Like, oh God. So, yeah, he has a vision right now of chopping Mei with a Japanese sword, but, like, that's all it is. It's a vision.
Yeah.
And I don't know why he's using, like, very extravagant weapons. Like, it's not something around his house. I don't think that thing was even there.
No,
like,
he's using a rolled-up newspaper as, like, a prop in his hand.
Like, IRL.
Right, and pretending that it's a fucking katana.
It's beautiful. So when Donald goes in the kitchen for dinner, Mei emphasizes that it's veal, his favorite. But naturally, and also, I want to say I love Mei because she's very just like Jersey wife.
And just and like, I don't, really over the top in a great way.
Yeah, like I hate everything about Jersey except for Jersey wives because I'm always like, yeah, you win, it's the veal. You know, it's great.
Like, she's telling you what your favorite is.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's oh, like, yeah. She decides what your favorite is. Like, what you like is what she likes for you. And that's good, I think.
Yeah.
Is that Stockholm Syndrome? Anyway, naturally, the veal's microwaved, which is fucking sick. That is so beyond sick. It's crazy. But Donald, like, he's like talking about, she's talking about how it's his favorite meal, you know? And he goes, well, Mei, I guess it was just lost in translation regarding it being his favorite meal, it being microwaved fucking veal.
Yeah, but I feel like his complaints are never about that, though. His complaints are just, oh, it's too fancy. Like, even if it would have not been microwaved, he still would have complained about it. He just wants a bologna sandwich. He just wants mac and cheese and hot dogs. Like, he doesn't want anything more than that.
I know. And I almost like, I was trying to like, I was pondering, trying to like defend him more and trying to like be like, no, it's because he doesn't want microwave veal. But you're right. Like, that's not like, the problem at all. Like,
this was a problem for him before the microwave came into the picture.
It's the fact that there's like sides next to it and the fact that she's like lighting candles and like trying to be fancy and stuff.
He's like,
and,
what like, the fuck?
And making him eat at the table too.
Why can't we just eat bologna sandwiches?
No, dude, there's a part later and like, I'll have the depiction down because I wrote it down, you know? But this is one point where he's like, my order is a fucking sandwich and it's in the garage or something like that. I don't know. I'll find it, but it's so fucking funny. It is one of the funniest shits I've ever heard. Anyway, So they set the mood for dinner. May starts a grease fire. Tough guy, you'd know something about that.
Yeah. This is another movie that I'm glad we did with you.
It wasn't you know, a grease all about fire.
Mickey Dolan's grease fire.
No, I like this scene though. Because she turns off the light to light the candles, right? But she drops the match in his drink and it lights up. Now I'm guessing
was that his drink? Because I don't know what the fuck.
Because it was flammable.
I thought that was like
but it was huge.
I thought that was like liquid incense that she was boiling.
I thought it was like an oil lamp.
I think
I think it was an oil lamp.
No,
right?
No, she served this drink to him intentionally and turn off the lights to try to go light the candle, but accidentally drops the match in his drink.
He drinking out of a fucking cheese melter.
I was gonna say it was like a
cheese chalice.
Fountain?
Yeah, it was a chalice.
But like a bowl.
Dude, that was like three different, like you had to, there were pieces you take out of it. Right,
I'm convinced it was his drink, and she put something in there to poison him, and she fucked up
and lit it on fire.
I love that.
She's cooking him all this fancy food that's good for him.
No, she's trying to kill him.
Tell me more about your theory.
That is my theory. That's it. And then she's like, why won't you eat it? He's like, that's like asking men why they climb mountains. Because they're there.
Because they're there.
I really had to think about that. Why I won't eat it because it's there.
Because it's
there. And
that's
what I'm saying. He's not going to be happy with anything.
No, he won't be happy with anything.
Because it's there?
He's sick of the shits May's making. And honestly, I don't know. I feel like, look, maybe I shouldn't be defending Donald and all these actions and whatnot. But if his biggest issue is that you don't make him simpler food. I don't know. You don't have to make all the fancy shit. Like, I don't know. Like, I'm not saying, like, she doesn't have to make him shit. But, you know, like, I feel like this dude would just shut up if she just, like, fucking grabbed a piece of bread and put a piece of cheese in between it and threw it at him.
It's true.
You know?
Could solve a lot of issues.
Remember that short we watched about the sandwich?
What? Killer sandwich?
She kept feeding a sandwich to that dude. And eventually she put like glass in it and then like dog shit in it.
Ooh,
no. Don't you watch that show with me? No,
no, that's maybe my not. Fear. Have you ever seen those?
That's my fear.
No, that my fear
that
at these.
Someone would feed me a dog shit in glass.
Can
sandwich?
I finish my? What else? Have you ever been to those blindfolded restaurants where they turn off the lights and then they serve you plates or food and you're just supposed to trust the chef? Have you ever heard of those? They're
I've
still active.
Well, I've definitely fed you a dog shit sandwich.
No, you probably give me dog food
dog
though.
Food
for sure, a dog treat.
Dog food sandwich.
You guys
want to
try a
sure.
dog food sandwich right now?
Sorry, Kim.
Well, speaking of dog food sandwiches, this is another. I wish Kim was here for this one. She knows something or two about eating dog food. Anyway, so the whole candles thing, his grumbling continues, you know, Donald, he's just going on. I don't like calling him Donald. I want to call him Jackie Vernon. I keep getting confused when I read Donald. I'm like, who the fuck is Donald?
Yeah, I don't like you calling him Donald.
Anyway, May's like, Donald, god damn it, maybe these candles will put you in the mood. He goes, I'm in the mood for something, but it isn't legal. Like, this dude is just talking about wanting to murder her right in front of her at all times. And she was like, wait, what was that? He goes, I didn't say anything, May. The way he just like, oh. So they continue speaking of how May wants to get dick down and how little Donald is interested in giving her a piece of his 1-2. And she's like, men are still into me. Look at this. And she like, you know, moves her boobs all around. And then she finishes with, she's like, you should know. And he's like, how should I know them? Regarding the men that find her attractive.
Should find her attractive.
He goes, I didn't attend the Braille Institute.
Oh my God. I love that you do his voice like he's a cartoon elephant.
This is what he sounds like. That's exactly what he sounds like. That's so good. The back and forth ends with May telling Jackie that their puppy eats better than he does. And he goes, you know, May, I think you're right. And then the next scene, you see an open can of dog food next to him. And
oh
then a,
God.
And then he's just eating like bread with all this like pink gushy shit
disgusting.
In the middle of
disgusting.
And a dog walks up at one point too. He's like, hey, buddy, you want a piece of this? Me Gag. And you aren't that different, me and you.
Made a friend. Shared his dog food sandwich.
He's eating it too. He's like, this isn't half bad.
He's loving it. Maybe he.
So.
He'd rather dog food sandwich than fucking king crab and bread.
I think he just likes low-end meat.
Couldn't he have just kept making his own lunch?
100%.
And everything like, would have been fine?
Like, that's why it was so hard for me to even say, like, the whole, like, hey, maybe she should have just, like, made him some shitty sandwich to shut him up. Because it's like, yeah, he could do whatever the fuck he wants.
He's like, fuck it, I'll just make my own. And it's like, bro, you could have still made your own bologna sandwich. You didn't have to make a dog food sandwich. You could have made the bologna sandwich that you've been bitching about for weeks. You could have just made it.
That's so much effort. I mean, later, Mason's going to be gone for a second. He's like, May, well, I gotta go to work. And he's just like, guess I'll just go in the microwave.
That's right.
Maybe she made me something in the microwave. It's so good, dude. It's classic. It's the best movie I've ever seen. So there's a lot of witty back and forth, like just upfront catcalling that has to do with like a skyscraper rising and...
Uh-huh.
He's talking about his dick.
Construction.
Say, baby, wanna wear my hard hat?
My thing's way bigger than a 2x4, baby.
This is how construction workers talk.
I just remembered in the credits they call this girl Not Whole Girl.
So my next note right now is that conversation is between Lauren Shine, who plays Roosevelt, and Marla Simon, who plays Not Whole Girl.
Not.
Oh, my God.
She's the assistant director in The Jar.
The Jar?
I don't know what that is.
Nope.
They called her Not Whole Girl.
That's insane.
It's fucking crazy. Like, I was looking for her name to reference her in this. And yeah. So not girl listens to Roosevelt for a bit before making her interest toward a strong man on the other side of the construction site. And Roosevelt, he's like, oh, you want to talk to this guy I got?
Oh, yeah, I know that guy.
I know that guy.
We can talk to that guy if you want to talk to that guy.
And he comes over, or he calls him over, and she's like, all right, go ahead. Talk to him. And then she goes, oh, my God. She touches his chest, like, in awe.
He's pretty buff. He's buff.
Dude, the dude's fucking yoked. Yeah.
The dude that's just...
He's just holding giant pieces of fucking scrap metal.
I-beams around.
What are we talking about? The dude's insane. Like, he could throw a car. I'm so convinced. But the second she starts touching his chest, he goes, don't do that. And he's like, what the... And she's just sitting there like, what the fuck is going on? And Roosevelt, he's just busting up laughing, and he walks away. He's like, don't do that, you son of a bitch. He's like, you know that I break out in a rash whenever people touch me. And then she's like, what the fuck is going... What rash? What kind of rash does that? Like,
no idea.
But yeah, she like walks off and Roosevelt's just still fucking busting up laughing. And then she walks over to him and they're just like dating now. Yeah. He's like, hey, so since it didn't work out with Mr. Rash Boy, I guess we're married now. She's like, guys only ever want one thing. And then he looks at her boobs, looks at each of them, and he goes, well, which one,
which
baby?
One?
Well, how do they choose?
How do they know?
And then they immediately start making out afterwards.
They start making out, and then he looks over at fucking Jackie Vernon, and he's like, because Jackie Vernon's just sitting there, like, fucking, like, making out with a dog. And he's just like, looks like you got one too, huh, Jackie?
You're making out.
He's got his little bud.
It's so ridiculous. This all happens in like 1 minute too. Like it all happens so fast. It's
just
great.
A lunch break, man.
It's so great.
No one ever working. It's always a lunch break.
Hard working, man, dude. So after a long, hard day, really, of eating dog food.
Wait, are we at the Grim Reaper crossing the street scene?
Oh shit! I forgot about. I don't think I even wrote anything about
it. I have it right here. This is next. Yeah. No, that's it. I don't know. And it's
you're
just like.
Right. I mean, that's all that happens.
It's is it a B-roll? Like what? What does it give to the movie? I don't.
It's coming for May. Her time's coming.
Maybe. Oh.
It's foreshadowing, dude. The Grim Reaper's come, dude.
Dude, I should have given this 5 stars.
Oh, this is the best movie ever. You give Tough Guy an inch of foreshadowing, he's like, holy
yeah,
shit, they planned all this out. Best
God.
Movie ever.
I love that shit. Thinking ahead, man.
Don't tell him it was all a dream.
No.
That'll easily bump into the number one movie on his
bro,
list.
What if it's a dream within a dream? How do you feel about that?
Dude.
What if it's a foreshadowed dream?
Foreshadowed dream? Like they're planning it? Give me an hour and a half... prologue.
Give me an hour and a half of bullshit and then tell me it was a foreshadowed dream.
I'll take it, man.
A simple man. We love to see it. So yeah, after this day of eating dog food, Dahl gets back home and he sees a lady with a cat at house 1400 and he goes, hey, and he's fucking wasted. This is like, this is so crazy. He's so wasted. And guys, I'm going to tell you right now, his next few lines are going to get vulgar.
This is rough.
He goes, hey, what a nice pussy. Oh, like, he says it so hard.
Yeah, the way he says it.
And then he goes, he repeats it four more times. He goes, yeah, pussy, pussy, pussy,
oh
pussy.
My God.
I was like,
it's Frosty the Snowman, guys.
And the woman next door, she starts like rubbing her hips seductively while he's saying it like over and over again. And guys, I want to repeat again. Jackie Vernon is a very short, very fat, just grotesque looking man. Like, he's not a beautiful man. I love him. I think he's beautiful inside and out. But out, I lied. Like, he definitely looks like a big toe. You
this
know?
Is rough.
Like, it's so fucking crazy, dude. This orgy house is relentless.
It is.
If Jackie Vernon was ever next door and he just looks at like a woman next door and starts saying, "What a nice pussy you have there," like, you gotta like be very worried and honestly get like security for your house, because like there's no way I'd be like just being like, if a woman in my life came to me and was like, "Yeah, so this is guy next door, like he just came home and he was blasted, like drunk, like I could smell the alcohol from the fucking house next door where I was standing." And I'm holding my cat, and he's being a fucking weirdo, and he's like, "Hey, what a nice pussy!" You'd be like, "You got to do something. You got to like get out of there. You got to like call someone to like."
I don't like that.
Like, I don't know what you have to do, but like, you're in a dangerous situation.
Ugh.
But no, she's like, "Come on, Jack, you want to come over here?" Like, he's thinking about, like, he's like, "Oh, should I cheat on my wife?" And it's like, how are you even in this situation right now? Like, you're being horrible, and somehow you're here? All right, like, this is a fever dream if I ever heard of one. So this sort of dialogue exchange when Jackie enters the home and speaks to May is nothing short of otherworldly.
He says, "I didn't come home drunk. I've been drunk all day."
That's which really... You're still coming home drunk. Like, that's my favorite part of that. I didn't come home drunk. I've been drunk all day. You haven't been home all day. But okay, this is the dialogue exchange. Wait, tough guy, are you on the one note right now?
Yeah.
Do you want go to mine real quick?
Oh no.
So you can go on the back and forth of this dialogue exchange with me.
Oh no, I'm afraid to.
It was great. Actually, this is gonna take too long. I'll go ahead.
Yeah,
I was gonna say
it's got me on Wolf Creek.
In real time, have him scrolling down trying to find where I am in the notes so we can read this one dialogue exchange. All right, so I'm gonna be both of them. You'll know when I'm Jackie Vernon.
Because it sounds like a cartoon.
You'll know who I am. Okay, so it goes like this. Starts out with Jackie.
"I want a bologna and cheese sandwich for dinner. And I want it served in the garage."
My favorite line in the movie. "I want it served in the garage." This is my voice for May. "Where have you been?"
"You got my order."
And then he just slams the door and he,
you got
he
my
tries
order.
To slam the door and leave. "Your order? You've got your nerve. What do you think you're doing coming home drunk and asking for a peasant sandwich when I've slaved all day over that microwave all afternoon?"
Slaved all day over the microwave. She really said that.
We're early in the microwave game, though. She was probably slaving over that, for sure.
It is true. I think that is a point to make, is that at this point in the microwave
early microwave era.
The microwave wasn't like...
It was in the kitchen, and it was a machine, so you were working on it.
Right. Like, it was made to be like, oh, hey, this is like your oven, but it does things a little bit faster. And it's like, we don't use microwaves like that now.
I mean, this was definitely microwave hysteria.
Like, I don't even like using the defrost mode in my microwave. Like, I'd much rather defrost things
naturally. Would rather die than defrost any type of meat in the microwave.
That's terrifying.
I know that's a thing that you could, like, technically do, and I've even seen my grandma do it, and my grandma is, like, a good cook, and, like, you know, I trust everything she makes. I don't give a fuck. I refuse. If I, like, oh... I fucked up the dinner. Guess I can't make that dinner tonight. If I can't find a way to defrost it without putting it in the microwave, It's not happening.
Yeah, you messed up.
I just fucked up. I'm not doing it.
For sure.
Because no. No. So yeah, and then he goes, I didn't come home drunk. I've been drunk all day. And then the microwave dings, which I thought was like a very, the timing was great. So now May tries to force Jackie to sit at the table and eat her dinner. So Jackie walks into the other room and he fills his mouth with water. And you don't see that. He just walks in the other room, but he comes back and then he just spits it all over her plate. But the way we see it, like he just walks in the other room, comes back, and then is like, well, what are you doing? He just goes, he spits it all over.
Leans over her shoulder to spit on her plate.
And she goes,
ah, ah, ah. It's like, remember what we did last in 1962?
He made a joke earlier because she's like, you haven't been horny since this, that, or whatever. He was like, or she was like, oh, when's the last time we had sex or something like that? He's like, I remember it. It was 1962. Like,
it was a Thursday afternoon. It was raining.
The biggest smartass in the world, dude. It's so funny. And so now when he walks back to the other room again, May starts screaming, don't you mess up my house. And Donald goes,
no wonder this place is so clean, May. The dirt is all in here. Well, I can fix that.
And then he just walks in the room with like the vacuum bag and just starts throwing it all over the place. Can you imagine going, no wonder it's so clean in here. The dirt's in here.
He's completely unhinged in this scene. He's pissing in the fireplace.
He's pissing in his own house. He gets pissed off at her and just throws dust everywhere and then pisses everywhere. And she's like, oh, come on, Jackie. You live here too.
Your house guy.
So he proceeds to smash up some items, again, his stuff, and eventually takes a piss. And at this point, May's like,
you know what, Jackie Vernon? I think something is bothering you.
Imagine it, like, someone has to do all this just for you to realize that they're in a bad mood.
They have an issue.
And May's face is so convincing here. She's like shocked, like, what? She's like, there is something wrong.
Like, you can tell she just learned right now. She's like, oh my God.
It's like I pushed him too far.
So he goes back to roasting her cooking, and then he tries to make her food money go far.
No.
Throws her food out the window. And then she flips the like a plate of food onto his head. Well, because he tries to make it go far.
Yeah.
Then she grabs it, flips it on his head, and this results in him just like, this is the best choking scene in any movie ever.
True.
The like just the fucking the shot, dude. The way is like the perspective of his face and his wrinkles. It was so good. It was incredible.
So he strangles her and hits her in the head with the salt shaker. And it's a salt shaker and it's messy. So to avoid being jinxed, I guess, he tosses salt over his shoulder. And then continues the strangler.
Important. That's important. That needs to happen.
He is beating her with the biggest fucking wooden salt shaker in the world. It is 9 feet tall. And yeah, I loved when he fucking gets the salt, throws over his shoulders, then it goes, and he kind of pauses for a second too, kind of like looks around, and then it like goes right back to bashing again. Like, it's so good.
The awareness, the awareness.
The close-ups and the camera shaking was just so good. It was great. So next day, he wakes up with a headache, and a lack of lunch. And this is when he heads over to the microwave. He opens it, and he finds May in the microwave. He just, like, opens it and looks at it. He's like, maybe there's some food in here. And he goes, oh, No. Like, first, May, he goes, oh, May's in the microwave. And then he turns around, and then he, like, sits there and lets it sink in. And then he goes,
May's in the microwave.
You're not exaggerating. It really goes like
as he's looking directly down the barrel.
Directly down the barrel of the lens.
Shatters the fourth wall.
Can we also talk about like the microwave door somehow opens kind of sideways, more like a refrigerator door? And, like, yeah, when we see May in the microwave, she's, like...
She's, like, layered in there.
Layered. I guess that's the way to describe it. Like the way...
Yeah.
Like, she's kind of just, like, in there.
How did they do that? I didn't look closely enough. Is she just standing in there?
She's kind of just like standing in there.
That was really fucking funny, though. That was actually Craig Muckler that they put makeup on because May didn't show up for shooting that day.
For real?
If you look at it, you can very much tell. You can very much tell. It's so funny.
It's wow. very short.
And his face
and
just looks like...
And that will explain why it's so short.
It's so goofy. It's great. It's like my favorite part.
I love yeah. that.
That's good stuff.
So he's like, May's in the microwave, and then he puts on slow boil. Broil.
Well, you gotta check it out. Yeah, she looks kind of goofy after that.
Yeah.
So when Mr. Jackie gets to work, he finally gets to embrace food that isn't microwaved, and he's so happy about it. And all his pals are like, holy shit, dude, your wife's going to beat you up. But he's like,
don't worry about May.
And when he gets back home, he just like dismembers her and puts her in the freezer.
Yeah.
So now Donald needs a plan. And he watches a TV show that discusses like eating all of the evidence. And he's amazed by the idea. Like, he's so dumbfounded. He's like, holy shit. I never thought of that before. So at night, he grabs a piece of arm, and he, like, I think he, like, kind of, like, was, like, I think he was, like, dreamwalking. Because, like, the way he bites into this arm and starts chewing on it, and then he looks at it, and he's like, like, he didn't know that he just grabbed an arm and started eating into it. Like, he's like, holy shit. Like, he's, like, it's presented like it was an accident.
Yeah. You know, he's just shocked at what he actually did, you know?
I don't know that that's what it is.
Can we also say at this point that anytime we say a hand, a foot, an arm, they are like cheap rubber.
The ones you buy at like fucking Halloween.
Spirit City. Halloween. Like yeah. Like,
even the spirit.
I was going to say, yeah, they're so cheap.
Like the ones you get for a dollar. They're like, you know, like they're like in the meat packaging with the saran wrap over it and shit. Like they're just like plastic little.
Yeah, none of the gore in this is grotesque whatsoever. Like, this is all just silly.
This part's awesome, too, because you can tell he's just, like, holding his hand over, like, the end of it. Like the part where it cuts off.
Yeah.
And then there's just, like, some kind of, like, meat that they put, like, in there. And he's just, like, holding on to the meat so you can't tell that he's just holding on to some piece of fucking meat with cranberry sauce or something on it that he's chewing on. It's awesome. But then he goes,
hey, not bad. I may have underestimated May's taste.
Oh, my God. Dude, the puns.
Oh, no.
Puns for days.
I also want to discuss when he's at work the next day, this enormously large rack of ribs that he's eating.
Yeah?
It's the size of his body.
Yeah?
And then the guys are all like, holy shit, where'd you get that from? That looks pretty interesting. And then they're like, let me get a taste, man. It's fantastic. It's a tummy turn on. One of them said that, I think.
They did say it was a tummy turn on.
And since the guys like the meat so much, Donald's like, all right, I'll bring you some more the next day.
So this is supposed to be
a hand kebab.
This is a cut of May, but like what cut?
The ribs, obviously, dummy. Can you imagine if human ribs were 6 feet long? Like, I mean, the only thing that I was thinking of is I was like, I guess maybe a spine, but this is easily 9 times the size of a spine, so even like the tallest person's spine in the world.
Yeah, this is intense, man.
It's pretty great. So we're back at the bar, and Jackie runs into a very pretty woman. She gets kicked out of the bar. And then she's seen outside with a broken heel. Jackie shows up and he's like,
you have a broken heel.
She goes, yeah. I'd probably look better with this broken heel in the dark, though. And then he's like,
yeah.
Then they go back.
Did she say, like, you ever screw in 3D?
Did she say that?
She did say that.
What does that mean?
I don't know.
What the fuck does that mean?
Dude, 3D was awesome.
Great.
Dude, they loved 3D in the 80s and 50s. And
great. Great explanations. I love it.
3D was awesome.
No, well, I was thinking of Back to the Future where the guy's wearing 3D glasses the whole time. And I just feel like it's like one, I don't know.
That's how I want to live my life. Then you start seeing life in 3D.
Yeah, man.
Whenever... I don't have any.
You talking about Google, the Apple goggles?
God damn it. Magic Apple. That's my Apple. So anyway, yeah, she's trying to fluff his pillows. Unfortunate for her, the fluffing ends in a muffling. She gets choked to death, is what I'm saying. When the scene transitions, Donald is about to chop the woman with an axe. And when it goes to the next scene, a bowling ball gets thrown into a car's trunk on top of a bottle of ketchup to symbolize blood spatter. And that just really... Glass ketchup bottles? Demonic. Throwing it in your trunk under a bowling ball? Demonic. That's crazy. It got all over the trunk, all over the clothes in there, all over the bowling ball. There's glass and ketchup everywhere. Yeah. That's my nightmare. Glass and ketchup.
Hopefully it was a prop car.
It's actually my fucking nightmare. There's nothing worse than that. I would rather someone feed me a fucking dog shit sandwich than a ketchup glass sandwich. Well, I guess other people might say that too. No. Actually, no. I'd rather take the ketchup glass sandwich. I'm not eating shit. That's sick. I'd rather die. Yeah. No, like that's what I'm saying. Like that's my statement, if I'm being completely honest. I would rather die.
Was it ketchup? It was supposed to be blood.
It was definitely ketchup in the bottle. I mean, it was a crazy thing that, I mean, it's clever and funny, and it makes you wonder why they're doing those things with the ketchup bottle. Glass ketchup bottles just scare me. Anyway. What do you guys think of when Jackie ordered food at a fast food joint, the drive-thru, and he's like,
let down your hair, unbutton your blouse, hike up your skirt, stick out your tongue, and a Coke!
And a Coke.
And a Coke!
And all of his buddies are like, ah!
And a Coke! Well, then he drives by and the woman at the window.
Great customer service.
She's all of it. And a Coke.
Doing the whole thing.
And a Coke.
And a Coke. That's probably this.
That's like
when I first watched that scene, I was like, why is this girl doing this dumb thing? And then I watched it again, and I was like, oh, she just do all the things that he said, all the dumb shit that I ignored that he said?
It was like it's that hilarious. Old YouTube video, was like a double cheeseburger, but hold that whole rap, and then they actually made it for him. It's like, all right, got it.
Yeah, well. And a Coke! That's good. So around this time, Robert Burns is spotted as the homeless man digging through the trash. He finds an arm. He scratches his balls with it, and he walks off. He just kept the
amazing.
Arm. He just kept the arm. He wanted the arm.
Mm-hmm.
It's crazy. So yeah, fun little fact. Producer / writer Craig went to Robert Burns' house one day to look at some of the old Microwave Massacre props, and he was having a yard sale. And Wes Craven was also there, and they were selling movie props for Wes Craven movies as well as some of the Microwave Massacre props for as little as like a dollar and a quarter each.
That's crazy.
Which I think is incredible. How great would it be to walk into a random garage sale and they have Microwave Massacre and like fucking props from like Hills Have Eyes and shit like that? And they're just selling them for like a buck or less.
Yeah.
Iconic.
Once upon a time.
Shout out Wes Craven, a real gem. So Jackie tries to go to the supply store for 6-foot cooking sheets.
yeah, why don't you have any of those?
When they don't have those, he's like, well, you have elephant-sized garbage bags, right? The Dumbo size?
You know, the Dumbo size.
And then the guy's like, you're really starting to fucking piss me off, dude.
Actually, this hardware store owner
funniest
might
dude
be my favorite character.
Yeah, between him funniest and the bartender, they're both yeah. great.
And then when he's starting to, like, irritate the dude, Jackie's like,
well, you at least have 10-gallon-sized mason jars, right? You at least have that, right?
At least.
And the guy's like, go on, you fucking freak. Get out of here. Like, get on out of here.
Then he picks up the phone. He's like, Coast Guard? Coast clear?
Coast clear.
Good.
Good. And then he fucking turns around. He, like, looks in the mirror. He's like, oh, wise guy, what are you doing here again? Or something like that, and it like runs off.
Oh, no.
So funny, I love that guy. Oh, God.
The first time, when he asked about the 6-foot cookie sheets, he goes, fresh out of that popular size.
That's good humor, man. That's just great.
I think he says, like, ever so popular size or something like that, too. Like, he had, I know, because yeah. that is exactly what he said, but he added some kind of pizzazz on it that just made it so,
it was
so
good.
Funny.
So much character in that character.
So good.
There's honestly so much character in this movie that I'm really, like, I'm really
dripping with character.
Dude, I'm really upset that I, like, legitimately, like, I want to know what headspace I was, like, six or so years ago.
Interesting.
Yeah, because I watched this, like, 6 or 7 years ago, probably, for the first time, and I didn't appreciate any of this, and I can't imagine, like, what headspace I was in that I didn't appreciate all this stuff, because this is all, like, shit that I love, right? Like, this is like my bread and butter, and I really remember, like, every time I thought about this movie, I've talked about it with someone, I'm like, that piece of shit, yeah, that terrible movie that like has nothing to offer. I don't know, man. I must have just, like, put it on and not paid attention, if I'm being honest. I must have just looked at it and been like, all right, there's a dude, and I see a microwave sometimes. I probably was just expecting.
You were just mad that there wasn't a killer microwave.
I think that's what happened, dude. I'm pretty sure that's all it was. All right. Well, anyway, after the owner tells Donald to scram, he goes home, and it would seem that he found a woman to take home with him on the way back, and he also finds a very large butter knife and a lot of mayonnaise. He should have went that, oh, yeah. He should have went to that store to get the fucking cooking sheets and the mason jars and everything, because where did he find a 4-foot butter knife?
Yeah, this industrial-sized jar of mayonnaise.
The industrial-sized bread.
And a 4-foot Wonder Bread slice.
Like, this woman's laying on this giant piece of bread. He just puts, he gets this fucking giant wad of mayonnaise, which is just sick. Almost
it's
like,
really gross.
So gross.
I don't know, mustard. And I don't know what. Yes, I do. And I don't know what they used. But whatever it is,
I think it was mayonnaise.
It's convincing enough that it looks like mayonnaise.
You cannot tell me that wasn't mayonnaise. I'm being so honest. Because if they got a knife that big, they could just get a bunch of mayonnaise. Like, even if they're not like getting it out of a giant size mayonnaise jar, like, I don't know, you could probably just pour a bunch of fucking mayonnaise on it, right? And then just like go for the glob. I think that was mayonnaise.
It looks like mayonnaise, which is so gross.
Legitimately,
can you imagine the smell?
But that's the thing, though. Everything that you like, you know, fake for the most part. You need a reason to fake it. Why would you? What reason would you need to fake the mayonnaise? I guess yeast infections, because that was a naked woman that they were rubbing that mayonnaise on, and it
probably cost. You could probably make fake mayonnaise
for cheaper than
buying real, because it's like an animal product.
I guess that might be true. I mean, that it would be a good amount of mayonnaise to buy. Yeah, like, that was a lot of mayonnaise.
It's a lot.
That's probably.
But they might have actually bought it. I don't know.
That'd probably have to be at least, like, what, like 15 of, like, the big size ones, you know? At least,
yeah.
Because that, maybe like 10 if you go, like, the large, large ones, you know?
Like the family size.
That's a lot of mayonnaise.
It's a lot of mayo, dude.
You think they ate it after?
I hope not.
Well, you'd have to. It's a waste of mayonnaise.
Ew.
Pass.
Well, people eat sushi off of naked women.
I was
going to
say, that is a thing, like, that's a whole thing. You're not wrong. That's a thing.
Showered before, they, like, disinfected the mayonnaise after.
I'd rather have that crab sandwich.
How do you disinfect mayonnaise?
How don't you? You don't disinfect your mayonnaise? You've been doing it wrong. You don't wash your fruit either, do you? Anyway, he's rubbing this fucking mayonnaise on her, and then he just puts a piece of bread back on her. So, like, it's implied that, like, because she also screams when he goes to slice it with the same knife.
Right.
But also, like, you're telling me you're making mayonnaise sandwiches out here? I guess mayonnaise and meat.
Mayonnaise and meat.
That's sick.
Mayo and bologna. That's all he wanted.
That's so wrong. But yeah, I guess he ate the sandwich. Next up on the plucking list, Donald meets a woman in a chicken costume, and he takes her back to his place.
That's the whole plot. You didn't skip anything.
No, he walks up to, like, this is it, beat for beat. Scene starts. There's a woman in a chicken costume. He walks up. He goes,
"Oh, you're in a chicken costume."
How does he convince?
Oh, he's so hot.
All of these women to follow him back to his place.
Spitting
just
game,
so
man.
Good looking. Just a really good looking guy.
You couldn't even hear what anything she was saying because it was so muffled in the chicken suit. So
you're not wrong. It wasn't that great. But then I thought that they were gonna do like sexual things in the chicken suit.
They got out of it pretty quickly.
I get back, and like as it's panning over, it's like, "Oh, well, I didn't know you were a breast guy. I thought you were a leg guy or something like that."
You're a leg guy, not a breast guy.
And I thought they weren't actually going to be doing something sexual, but then you pan over, and he's motorboating her.
Oh, yeah, he's going for it.
So I don't know, they kind of doubled down on that joke, you know? I thought they weren't going to do it, but then they did. Anyway, we see, a severed food being placed on a table, like a food being like a leg or something, because that's food to him at this point. Like they're presenting it as food, you know. Like
right, yeah.
So he killed her. Like this is how the kills go in the movie. Like you just see like a body part being like eaten or like chopped up or something like that. And it's like, all right, so I guess you killed that person you were just with.
This movie kind of has a lot of things in Skinner. Common with Skinner.
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah.
Or just movies that don't want to show their kills, I guess.
Well, yeah.
That don't have movies without a budget, really. I mean, but anyway, due to all of the recent changes in Don's life, he decides to see a therapist. And some of the insane things he says to the doc is that in his free time, he enjoys counting smushed animals on the street.
Yeah, that's fun for him.
Brutal. He also says that women never excited him. Until he imagines eating them after the deed is done. And then he goes, hey, Doc, does it make me crazy if I need to have a woman for dinner after I screw her? And then he goes on about how great it felt to have that out in the open. And the doctor's kind of ignoring him. He's been sleeping, yeah, really. Sleeping
audibly snoring.
Yeah. It's not, like, subtle. Like, he's very obviously sleeping. And then the doctor wakes up. He's just like, well, everything sounds normal. And then Jackie's like, wait. I can't make love to a woman unless I eat her. He's like reiterating because he's like, Doc, are you sure this is okay? And since Doc was asleep, he goes, well, why not? This is the age of liberation, time of romantic sophistication. And if it helps you achieve a higher plateau of, it feels good.
By the great Gatsby, go down on her.
Go down on her, he says.
And no. Yeah, you know, fucking Jackie Vernon being the idiot that he is, he takes this bozo advice to heart.
Definitely thinks that this is permission to just keep killing and eating women.
Definitely just knew he was asleep and was just like, well, this is my chance. Like, this is my justification.
Said it was okay.
Insane. So then he, you know, he cut another woman to, you know, you gotta to retrieve her heart. And he took the advice to heart, cut a woman. It's hard.
I get it.
So he's at the point of microwaving all of his womanly feasts. And at one time when he's near the microwave, Donald has some weird breathing fit. This is going to come back later. It's like a fucking 45 second scene where he's just sitting there like, just breathing. But around this time, he seems to be losing it because May's head is just rolling all around the place. Like, he's just losing it. Like it being the head.
Right.
It's just gone, and then it'll be in, like, different corners. And when he goes to retrieve it, a woman named Evelyn shows up at the door. Evelyn is May's sister.
Yeah.
She's worried about where May is because she hasn't heard from her in a while. And Donald does this fun thing where when Evelyn turns around, Donald goes, here she is, and then, like, pops her head up. And the music's like, dun, 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 dun.
Also, again, I need to reiterate, her head just looks so
great.
I mean, it's great, but it's so cheap. It's so cheap. It's not realistic. This isn't scary.
It's just like her.
No, it does.
What?
No, it does.
What are you talking about?
It looks like paper mache.
It looks similar.
Yeah. Painted paper mache.
Somewhat similar.
I'll take it.
The size isn't even quite right. It's a little too small to be the size of a real person's head.
Talking about my penis? What are we talking about here?
Always. Always.
Anyway, so Evelyn continues her worry and ends up in May and Donald's bedroom, where she realizes that May is nothing but a severed head. But before she can react beyond screaming, Donald sneaks up from behind with a nice baguette.
No, can we talk about how crazy it is that he just sets the severed head on top of the bed with a bunch of pillows?
And she's talking to it for probably 3 minutes before she realizes that.
I honestly thought he was
Ferris Bueller. Am I looking at right?
I thought he was going to get away with it the way this movie was rolling.
I was so positive. I thought she was going to walk in. She was going to be like, "May, well, oh, you're real silent today." May. Like, you're real quiet today, May. I'll check on you later.
No, she has a real connection with her sister. She knows something's up.
That's her severed head.
Yeah, totally.
I mean, only a sister would know. Yeah. Only a sister would know. So he has this baguette, and he just...
Hang on, you talked about the best choking scene earlier. I thought this was the best joke. Hands. I know, but it was... This is a different kind of choking.
Dude. This is great. I thought he murdered her.
So did I. I thought she was dead.
I thought she was dead, dude. It's so crazy that she did it.
I actually was taking notes, and I went to write down, and then he kills a woman by shoving bread down her throat.
I counted her as a kill.
I thought he was just concerned by her carb intake.
I mean, she was about to intake this fucking baguette.
She needs to be on the Atkins diet.
Yeah. Dude, so he like sticks his baguette in her mouth and like he starts choking her with it. Like, and she's like, oh, like, I don't know. If someone stuck a baguette in my mouth, I'd probably bite it. You know,
start
like,
chewing.
Yeah, like do anything, but like he chokes her with it until she passes out. Then she's just on the floor, just out with a baguette sticking out of her mouth. And like I said, like fully thought she was dead.
Yeah,
like this is a murdered woman. So he puts her in the closet, and then he ends up at a doctor's office.
Oh, well, hang on, he puts her in the closet because he's gone this far with her, and then he's like,
"Oh, he starts, no, you're right." He starts going, "Ew."
I can't do that to her because in his brain, he's like, I have to follow through, well, which means says, I have to have sex with her and then eat her.
But all, it's funny, though, because he says, he goes, I can't eat you. Ew, ew, ew. And he doesn't say, like, you know, he has to fuck her, but that's implied right, because that's the whole thing with his therapy that's and, like, thing, what he's been doing every time. Like, that's his ritual at this point. He's like, like, he starts, like, dry heaving. He's like, May's sister, gross.
It's pretty crazy.
You're right. I'm really glad I didn't go over that because it was so funny. So he's at the doctor's office, and this piece of shit doctor.
Dude, this doctor's awesome. I think it goes.
This doctor's awesome.
It goes
this
bartender, doctor, and then that convenience store guy.
These characters, they're crazy.
They're great. He's
never go back to this doctor's office.
And he's sharpening his skills with his accuracy skills.
What are you talking about? Dude's almost throwing. Fucking use needle at me.
Hey, who's to say they're used?
Checkup.
Who's to say they're used? And he's getting bullseye, so you know he knows what he's
good.
Doing.
He's pretty good at it.
Say they're used.
Okay, he did have.
Of course they're used. You think he's not pulling those out of the fucking hazardous trash can in there? Of course he is.
Out of the sharp.
I don't think anyone's seeing this doctor. That's how I know that they're not used.
There's no.
It's fucking crazy. He opens the door and this. Fucking doctor, he has a dartboard on the door, and he's throwing syringes at it.
Yep.
So if you, so Jackie opens the door, and he almost gets a syringe in the middle of his face. This is not my doctor.
He's a great doctor.
What are we talking about? This is crazy.
Very good doctor.
I need a new primary physician immediately. This is crazy. The doctor's like, hey, man, you're okay. You got that pacemaker and everything, but you're okay. You're going to live a lot of years.
You can do everything you could have done 15 years ago. Oh, when he checks on him too, he puts the stethoscope on the wrong side of his chest.
And he's like, oh, shit, you're dead.
Yeah, I was like, holy shit.
So we move on to the next scene. We now see that Evelyn, the sister, is tied up in Jackie Vernon's closet. And the remainder of the baguette that's sticking out of her mouth, acting as a gag. Like, it's like gagging her so she can't speak. Yeah. And it's also growing mold at the end of it.
I was really
but it looks
hoping
like...
that you picked up on that. Yeah. Every time we flash back to her, there's more mold.
More mold on it. More mold just on the end of the bread. On the end of it.
It's amazing.
And it, honestly, it looks like she's like... It looks like what Charles Band would think a blunt is. You know what I mean? Like, poking out of her mouth. Like, it's fucking ridiculous. It's so crazy. I'm surprised I didn't see that in an Evil Bong movie.
Where he's just like, yeah, dude, token mad joints, dude.
Mean, green, no, wicked.
No. This isn't even the same show.
What are we talking about, dude?
Get out of here.
Wicked baguette.
So Jackie Vernon continues his cycle of bringing women back to his house, and this time he finds a beautiful brunette woman with a nice cat shirt. And unfortunate for her, Donald greets her with some fancy knives and an apron. I'm surprised he didn't go, pussy, pussy, pussy. So now she's gone, as in dead. The next door neighbor at house 1400 is using a vibrator to dig up some dirt in the front lawn. Mm-hmm. And even though Jackie Vernon is fully murdering and eating people, he looks to her while she's digging with his fucking vibrator and he goes,
that is one strange lady.
That is one strange lady. What are you talking about? You have one strange life.
I know.
What are we even talking about?
It's amazing.
So now Donald and his boys decide to go for a wrestling match at the Dome.
Yeah.
You can relate to that. and Donald agrees to bring the snacks. He's like,
oh, I got it. And they're like, wouldn't have it any other way, Don.
And he's at home whipping up some good old chopped arm next to the hot microwave, you know, slaving over the microwave, you know. It's just the irony here, man. And then his buds, Roosevelt and Phillips, show up. And when they arrive, Mr. Jackie Vernon is passed out on the floor. And they're just kind of like, hey, dummy, get up. They're doing that for a while until one of them's like, he's down. Man down.
He's down.
And they find out that Donald is in fact dead when they get closer and they assess the situation. They also look at the microwave. And wait, tough guy, what does he say?
I so see it, but I so don't believe it. Yes, sir. I know I'm gonna be sick. Dude, this dude, okay, if we do this, if we reboot Microwave Massacre, I wanna play that guy. 100%. Please, I'll like grow out a full afro. No, that was sick. And their whole wardrobe's so cool.
In the movie, hands down.
He also says earlier, he has a quote. He's like, oh, I lost it. My bad. Never mind. It's don't have a quote.
He equally seems like he's constantly overacting and also have never acted before and also is a masterclass comedian.
Yeah.
100%. All at the same time.
Oh, 100%. Here it is. He says, what do you get when you double cross a mobster and an exorcist? Beats the hell out of me.
Oh, solid. Dude, the puns in the
guys are awesome
for this fucking movie. Oh god. So the microwave, yeah, it's filled with human parts. Not only that, Roosevelt looks closer. He sees a sticker inside the microwave that says, "Warning: This microwave may affect pacemakers." Which that was the best very cherry on top.
Very
you're telling
specific.
Me you don't put that on the outside of the microwave. Yeah. That was so funny. Yeah. On the inside of the microwave, where you have to look so hard to find it. Gosh. Warning: This microwave might kill you if you have a pacemaker. And it's on the inside in the like the most listen, impossible.
They're early in the microwave game, man.
They didn't know how to do things yet, man.
It says like fucking XJ19ZU in like the biggest letters on the front, but they couldn't say, hey, this one thing might murder you.
You know?
Oh, shit.
Things were different back then.
So the final scene in the movie consists of some type of cleanup team, like, ridding the house of the microwave or body parts. I don't think it's body parts. I think it's the microwave.
It seems like it's more focused on the microwave.
The microwave.
Sure.
I'm not entirely sure because
I feel
it starts...
we don't really get a great closure for, like, the crime scene of all of these bodies.
No. This is not a crime scene. I don't see any tape. I don't see any authorities. I don't even know how the body got taken out of there.
Like, this is the ice cream truck killer being found out, is what should have just happened, right?
Yes.
No, the house is already for sale. It says two rooms, one bath, and it says microwave, and then it's crossed out. The microwave part. It's like, no, this microwave doesn't come with it.
Seriously, I did not see that. Yeah. That's so funny. 10 out of 10. That's so funny. I might give this a 5-star just for that. Cross out the microwave. That's hilarious. So this part's so funny because it starts with like one of them opening the closet and finding Evelyn tied up, and the guy goes, he like laughs at first, he like looks and he's like, huh. And he goes, hey guys, you gotta come see this.
Get a load of this. Some lady held hostage in a closet.
And it's so funny too, because like I'm assuming they're here to clean up microwave, but like Jackie Vernon's body's already gone. The body parts are already out of the microwave. So there's some kind of crew came here to like, you
right,
know, get rid of
right,
all that.
Right.
Never saw.
You left the chick in the fucking closet?
Oh,
she was gagged. They wouldn't be able to hear her.
With a baguette.
Yeah.
And the head in the fridge, in the garage.
It's very moldy by this point.
I smelled over there. All the mold.
I smelled the baguette.
I wouldn't get near that. Baguette's terrifying. Anyway. So, yeah. It would seem that he's gone, and then they don't search the house. They don't do anything. It kind of just, like, it basically ends. I mean, there's two dudes fucking with the microwave. They're like, huh. Pacemaker. This thing fucks up pacemakers. And then we just kind of like zoom in on May's severed head. Her eyes glow and we fade out into a nice song. And that's the end.
She got her redemption, man.
The microwave. She did.
This was so funny.
Le
it's
chef.
A funny movie.
This was really funny. This was seven. Had seven kills. I think I rated this a 4.
Yeah, 4 stars.
It's a 4-star movie for mm-hmm. sure. Tough guy.
Yeah, I gave it 4.5. I actually found it really entertaining. It was a lot of fun.
It goes by so fast. It's funny all the way through. Like, this is definitely a movie that I would just put on, like, anytime, just for, like, a movie night or something. Like, it's so fun to watch.
It's good laughs, man.
And to think I gave this probably, like, a 1/2 star or 1 star when I watched it a long time ago.
That's
I was like,
crazy.
This is fucking terrible.
This movie was made for you.
I definitely was just not paying attention and didn't give it a chance. Yeah. Like, this is definitely the definition of, like, I did not give this movie a chance whatsoever. Because this is great. I love Microwave Massacre, and I would definitely recommend watching it.
This is gold B-movie night to watch with friends.
Yeah.
It's great. Like, I mean, don't expect, like, the greatest cinematic masterpiece in the world, but if you're looking for something funny as hell to watch, or just, like, really just The humor is, like, definitely very specific. Like, if you don't like, I mean, it's pretty dry humor, honestly.
Kind
of,
yeah.
Like, I mean, some of it very much isn't, but, like, some of it is just, like, Jackie Vernon, his deliveries are, like, so just.
Yeah.
I mean, but they're great.
They're amazing.
It's amazing. I love it so much. So we rate different categories in the movie. So let's rate the characters of the group. I'm going to rate the characters 5 out of 5. Easily. If I'm thinking Jackie Vernon, I'm thinking his homies at the construction Jackie site. I'm thinking of all of them.
They're great. It's 5.
Whole girl is confusing.
5 out of 5 on her, too. I love her. About you, tough guy?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, 5. Oh, sorry. For sure.
Did the story make sense?
No, especially the beginning.
Look, if I put it in terms of a guy got mad as his wife's cooking and he killed her, and then he started killing people because of it, that's on track.
It all makes sense. That all makes
like
sense.
It makes sense, yeah. You know? I mean, like, it's not totally bonkers.
I'm
saying it's, like, insanely well thought out, but, like, I don't know.
Or good.
For like, what the movie was going for.
It's not a great story, but it does make sense.
I can't really say it doesn't make sense. I'll give it a 4.
Yeah.
Yeah. James?
I'll give it a 4.
Yeah, and it's really for the intro. And I didn't really get into the movie the first time I watched it until he's like, Meg. And then, like, I started understanding, okay, I see what we're doing here. Because it's just chaos, and it really doesn't make sense at first.
So what do you think?
What?
Out of 5?
Yeah, 3.5.
Okay.
As far as making sense.
No, that's fair. How good were the kills?
Nah, we're not watching for the kills. There's cannibalism.
I'm going to give it a 3. And that's only for the fact that there was a lot of mayonnaise on that one woman.
that was more gross than any, like, blood or gore.
Like, I might not have, like, seen that, but, like, right. The implied fucking putting globs of mayonnaise on a woman and then putting intense. A piece of bread on it and chopping it in half is hilarious, so I give it at least a couple points for that.
Yeah, I'm at a 3 there, too.
Yeah, 3, sure. 2?
Yeah.
James is rolling in his grave. killer/killer, so we're just gonna go with Jackie Vernon. And the microwave. Dude, that's a 5. Jackie Vernon is the best killer ever created.
The best killer.
For sure. Like, I'd put him up there with, like, the slasher goats.
I'd argue he's probably the worst killer. Because he just threw May's sister in the closet. Like, that's not killer.
Well, he don't want to kill her because then he'd have to sleep with her. That's why he was, like, keeping her alive.
Yeah,
you
can't have feelings if you're a killer.
He doesn't have feelings. That's the problem. He doesn't want to have any feelings for her.
No.
even if those feelings are blood in his penis, he's like, not for Evelyn. It's a tough guy. What do you think?
No, the character is cool, but as a killer, no. But it's a 3.5.
Okay, I'll take it. Pacing of the movie, 5 stars.
Oh, yeah, 5.
Dude, it goes by so fast.
Yeah. Never bored.
Dude, not bored at all. I watched it like 9 times.
Yeah, never bored.
Great time.
5 stars.
Gets easier to watch.
I'm going to give that stain at least a 4.
Oh, the snake.
I mean, I'm going to give the microwave at least a 4.
I think
the microwave's incredible.
I'll give it a 4 overall.
I don't know. Dude, no, it's pretty
Dolan's
bad.
House,
Mickey Dolan's
your best
house.
Friend, Mickey Dolan?
I don't know, man.
Yeah, you're home.
There's the construction site. Call him right now. All right, well, how about Jermaine Jackson? Is that better?
I'm just kidding.
I don't know, man. I don't know. The construction side, the bar is cool. The bar is vibing. I do like that. I'll give it 3. Yeah, I'm at 3 with it.
Okay. All right. I'll give the stain a 4 still.
I'm giving it a 4 on the set design. If nothing else, then that huge ass syringe the doctor is using to almost hit Jackie in the face.
Fucking crazy. Wow. Fuck that syringe. I think next on the show, guys, is Hellraiser. I think we're doing another Hellraiser next. I'm pretty sure it's Elena next. So moving through that again. And thanks so much for listening, guys. If you made it this far, you're a real one. If you really enjoyed the show, do us a favor, tell a friend about the show. And if you really enjoy the show, leave a rating and review on whatever you listen to the show on. And Yeah, if you guys want more of like us three specifically together and like other variations of us and maybe like two of us together sometimes and maybe all three of us and another person and all those variations. Horror Soup, it's on all streaming platforms, audio, video-wise, pretty much. I don't know what all the video platforms are on, but it's in the ones that you're going to try to watch it on for the most part. Yeah. And as far as our show, we do bonus content on patreon.com/screampodcast. This is where I'll be thanking the listeners on a pre-recorded thing that I did before. Mm-hmm. Hello, everyone. This is the portion of the episode where I would like to give thanks to some of our beautiful Patreon donators. Thank you to Holly Alvarado. Thank you to Molly Wollstonecroft. Crazy cool name. Thank you to Thomas. Thomas. I almost called you Thomas. Thank you to Thomas Pierce. Thank you to Alex Penrod. Penrod. Melis H. Trisha. Bella Deletsky. Deletsky. That's a cool name, too. Thank you to Allie Kenny. Thank you to Courtney McCubbins. Thank you to Elizabeth Ann Gonzalez. Caitlin S. Lillian Bedell. Emily Swenson. Swenson's interesting. Desiree Rose. Mal, with a question mark. Mal is a little confused, a little concerned. Mal, what's going on? Why is it a question mark? What are you confused about? What's the question? Gabriella Barnier, Caitlin Hoyt, Taya Pope, JoJo, a.k.a. Joe Mama Bear Overholt. We have Naomi Chadwick, Bianca. Thank you to Julie Scott. Thank you to Phoebe Capone. Capen? Thank you to Zoe Oprey. Oprey. DM Novo. I lost my place. DM, who was last? DM Novo. We got Black Rabbit 215, interesting screen name. We have Natty Flo, Rachel O'Shea, Hannah Kirchgater. Kirchgater. We have Andrea Fernandez. Thank you, Andrea Fernandez. Thank you, Tanya. Sienna Williams, Jesse Vega, Kimberly Renee Crowell, River Goddess, K Moss, Sushi. Shout out Sushi. Why was that such a tongue twister for me? Jeremy, Carter Bowman, Shelby, Michelle C, Sharon Bennis, Emily, Taylor Wojvodich, Julia Murinitsky, Murawinski, Tiffany, Stephanie Crawford, Nicole Kreitz, Melissa Sanchez, Nicole Kowalski, Gabby Epperson, Kath, Arlie, Elena Bones, and Amy Samlon. I thought that was Salmon. Amy Samlon. Thank you so much to all of you guys. If you guys are curious how people got the thanks, they donate over on patreon.com/screampodcast. And we can't thank them enough because supporting us is very polite. And thank you. Thank you. Helps us do what we're doing. You guys are awesome. Thank you so much. If you want to follow the Scream socials, we're on Instagram at Scream Podcast, Twitter at The Scream Pod. I'm doing Letterboxd movie reviews at Horror Soup Caleb. Tough Guy is at Vibes_Cleveland on Letterboxxd. James is at Night Shift Video on Letterboxxd. And you can email horrormovierequests@yahoo.com with horror movie requests and everything else to screampodcast@yahoo.com. You can send some stories or some other stuff, whatever else over there, you know? And Ash and Elena do another show called Morbid. They do one called The Rewatcher and Frozen Heads. Those are all on all the audio streaming platforms. And thank you to Ethan Hurt, a.k.a. the composer of the Class of Nukem High theme song and the composer of our Scream, Scream, Scream intro song. You can find him by visiting www.ethanhurt.com. Troma legend. Troma loves us here. Ooh. And another big thank you to Kyle Herman for creating our Space Painless and Endless Corn outro song. Just search Kyle Herman on the internet and you'll find his work. And this show is
the show is covered in mayonnaise.
This show is not whole girl.
Selena and Caleb, they met through some tweets. Exchange them digits, now life is so sweet. Zooming all the time to record new episodes. Slanging the jokes to make our heads all explode. On PCP, I'm trapped inside a VHS. Scream, baby, scream, you know who do it the best. Through Anna's eyes, the team is ready to go. Fighting round the world, shout out to Russell Crowe. Oh, space penis and endless corn. I've wanted the scream since the day I was born. Best friends ever, truly the greatest team. Eggs, 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 we just living the dream. Space penis and endless corn. I've wanted the scream since the day I was born. Best friends ever, truly the greatest team. Eggs, 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 we just living the dream. Internet homies, yeah, we tight like that.
You wanna mess with Scream? Well, we might fight back. I'm still in that VHS, bad drug experience, a window that is secret. Johnny Depp, are you hearing this? We top-notch, podcasting the day away. What you say? Friendship on full display. My penis is in space, if you think that is odd. I'm wishing for endless corn and eggs for the squad, Space penis and endless corn. I've wanted the Scream since the day I was born. Best friends ever, truly the greatest team. Eggs, 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 we just living the dream. Space penis and endless corn. I've wanted the Scream since the day I was born. Best friends ever, truly the greatest team. Eggs, 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 we just living the dream. Space penis and endless corn. I've wanted the Scream since the day I was born. Best friends ever, truly the greatest team. Eggs, 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 we just living the dream. Space penis and endless corn. I've wanted the Scream since the day I was born. Best friends ever, truly the greatest team. Eggs, 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 we just living the dream. Since the day I was born. Best friends ever, truly the greatest team. Eggs, 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 we just living the dream. Space